Dear viewers of the Tom Photo channel, the more recent Nikon entry-level DSLR cameras used to ship with either the AF-P DX 18-55 GVR2 or NIKKOR AF-P DX 18-55 GVR. What are the differences? Should you prefer one to the other? This is what I'm investigating for you today. Let me, for simplicity, call these lenses AF-S and AF-P. I'm giving these lenses points as I talk to see which one gets a better score in the end. The two lenses were released 2 years apart, with the AF-P being a newer release. What made Nikon decide to go for an update? On the outside, the two lenses look kind of similar. They are both about the same size and very similar in weight too. The AF-S has a bit more elongated shape, and the AF-P weighs 10 grams more. The minimal focusing distance favors the newer AF-P by just 3 centimeters, which is not significant. So far, nothing major. Both lenses have a locking system. When you don't use them, you can lock the zoom so that the lens is maximally small and protected. To make the lens usable, you need to press the lens button and turn to unlock. This is not a bad design. But look at the side of the lens, and you'll see that the AF-S has two additional buttons. One lets you switch on and off vibration reduction, and the other one switches between automatic and manual focusing. In my view, this is a major advantage of the AF-S, making it a more versatile and also more intuitive to use. With the AF-P, you'll need to search in the menu to achieve all that, and this is no fun. Fat bonus points go to the AF-S from me, and we have an early leader. The zoom feels the same on both lenses, a bit plasticky feel, but nothing bad. The manual focusing ring is about equally responsive and good to the touch. I do not have preferences. But what is going on when we try to turn it? The AF-P does everything internally, but the AF-S's front starts to extend. I don't know about you, but I much prefer when the lens does not change its shape during focusing. This seems like yet another chance to break something. So my points for this section go to the AF-P, and we now have a tie as a result. Looking at the front of the lens, we notice that their filter size is different. The AF-S uses a 52mm filter and the AF-P uses 55mm filters. I think 52 is a bit more common across all lenses, and 52mm filters are also cheaper. Plus, you can adapt your 55mm filter to the 52mm lens using an adapter. But the other way is less preferred. I have to give a point to the AF-S, and as a result it pulls ahead again. Let me tell you the main reason the AF-P lens was released. It is the motor behind the focusing system. The silent wave motor in the AF-S has been replaced with a pulse motor or a stepping motor in the AF-P. This contributes to smoother and quieter autofocus operation. And this matters when you record video because you get less of the unwanted noise. Let's record the different sounds of the focus motor. This is what the two lenses sound like when they focus. I think the AF-P is appreciably quieter and I like it. This is the sound the lenses make when they focus hunt, when they cannot focus due to the subject being too close, and they are aggressively searching around. This time, the AF-P's advantage is not as evident because a higher pitched sound comes in that is certain to be heard in the video. Still, overall, the AF-P is a bit quieter indeed. I need to give a point to the AF-P, and we have a 2-2 tie again. The AF-P may also focus a little bit faster, so the point I gave it is well deserved. What really matters is photo quality. I tried various combinations with these two lenses, but could never confirm that one is visibly better than the other. As far as I can tell, these lenses are really very comparable. I've compared the AF-P with a 50mm prime lens before, and the prime lens was visibly sharper. Please see my link to this video in the description. Both lenses feature vibration reduction. Based on my not very scientific personal opinion, after using both lenses, I'd say that the amount of vibration reduction you get is the same with both lenses. I checked the prices of these two lenses too, and one was not consistently more expensive than the other. On average, the older AFS may even sell a little higher because it has those extra buttons that people tend to like. On the other hand, people are usually prepared to pay more for a newer model. So how to decide which lens will win our standoff today? It can only be the f-stop versus sharpness graph. The links in the description show how I make these graphs. Let's look at the sharpness at three different focal lengths, 18mm, 35mm and 55mm with Nikon D3400. I photographed a plywood board of 90 by 80 centimeters, being closer to it for the wide angle and farther away for the telephoto end. Always staying as far from the board as possible, but at the same time ensuring that it filled the entire frame. All graphs represent averages of two measurements. These are the AF-P sharpness graphs. The sweet spot is 11 for all focal lengths. Additionally, we observe that the shorter the focal length, the more the best performing f-stops tend to be on the left. At 18mm, the lens is maximally sharp between f8 and f13. The dip at f10 is not an experimental problem. It is consistent and replicates reliably. At 35mm, the curve has shifted slightly to the right. The best f-stop range is between 11 and 14. At 55mm, the curve has shifted a bit to the right again compared to the 35mm graph. It appears that you can go all the way to f16 with this lens. However, it is crucial to emphasize that camera software may be responsible for reducing apparent diffraction, making the higher f-stop seem like a good option. I wouldn't be surprised if f16 was not a good option for this lens with non-Nikon cameras. Also note that we cannot determine which focal length yields sharper results because I standardized the values, setting the highest value equal to 1 for all focal lengths. The AFS graphs differ from those of the AFP. Roughly speaking, all focal lengths yield a similar sharpness profile. Once again, the sweet spot is 11 for all of them, just like with the AFP lens. These graphs suggest that even f16 is a usable option with the AFS when paired with a Nikon D3400. This is impressive, and it makes the AFS a good option for landscape photography. Let's compare the two lenses by focal length. We're comparing the 18mm curves and they look different. The optimal f-stops for the AFP are much smaller than those for the AFS. However, the best value for both lenses is still the sweet spot value of 11. In a way, the AFP looks more typical and the AFS is more of an outlier when considering most typical zoom lenses. At 35mm, the shift between AFP and AFS is still present, but smaller than it was at 18mm. At 55mm, the shift is essentially gone, and the two lenses yield the same results. Note that I cannot determine which lens is sharper because the values were standardized to make the sweet spot values equal to 1. So finally, we found a relevant difference between the two lenses, and this is in their optical properties. I cannot definitively say which lens is sharper overall. The photos look the same up close. However, I can say that I would be very uneasy shooting anything at f16 or above. The AFS may be a great landscape lens, while the AFP is a bit more traditional, and I prefer its characteristics more. I guess I would trust it a little more. So the point for optics goes to the AFP, and we have a winner. With a score of 3-2, I would choose the AFP lens as my kit lens. The lenses are very similar, however the AFS is undoubtedly a very good option as well. If you already own it, don't trade it for the AFP. They both get the job done very well. Thank you so much for joining me in this battle of Nikon kit lenses. Please check my links below as well. If you found this video useful, I'd like to ask you to consider subscribing to my channel and leaving a like. Have a great day. Goodbye.